Welcome to the Black Entrepreneur Experience Podcast, inside the business, buzz, and brilliance of Black entrepreneurs. Here is your host, Dr. Frances Richards.
What happens in Vegas goes all over the world on Black Entrepreneur Experience, episode number 232.
Subscribe to our mailing list to receive weekly updates and exclusive content delivered right to your inbox. Go to drfrancesrichards.com. That's drfrancesrichards.com to subscribe to our mailing list and be entered into our monthly drawing. That's drfrancesrichards.com, drfrancesrichards.com to subscribe to our mailing list and be entered into our monthly drawing. We promise we won't spam you or sell your information.
Thank you for joining us as we elevate the Black entrepreneur experience by interviewing CEOs, thought leaders, innovative thinkers, and Black entrepreneurs across the globe. I'm your host, Dr. Frances Richards. An American based in England, she lives south of the river in London with her husband and two sons. She's an author and fashion director of Grazia, UK. Welcome, Kenya Hunt.
Hi, thank you for having me. Great to meet you.
I've given our audience such a brief bio. Why don't you fill in the gaps and share with us what you'd like them to know about you and the new book that you just released?
As you mentioned, you know, I'm an American expat living abroad here in the UK. I've been here for over 10 years now, 11 years. And I've written a book called Girl, 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 spelled three different ways, on womanhood and belonging in the age of Black girl magic. It explores how modern Black womanhood looks against the backdrop of social media. It's essentially a love letter to Black women, really. And it really looks at how we show up for one another and advocate for each other in a world that often does not. And I have an incredible group of contributors who have written essays that are a part of the book as well. And they're all just inspiring women in their own right. Some of them are really dear, close friends. Others are women I've admired from afar, and they represent a range of places. So the book, it feels quite diasporic in that way. So we have, you know, a group of women whose origins range from everything from the West Coast, California in America, to Lagos, to Cameroon, to Uganda. So there's a real sort of cross-section of voices and points of view in the collection of essays.
Talk about the decision to move to the UK.
Yeah, so I had always wanted to live abroad. I mean, I had so many friends who had studied abroad, and I never had the opportunity to do that. And I was born in Germany and then, you know, raised in the States in Virginia, and moved to Texas when I was really small, and then spent the bulk of my childhood in Virginia. And at university, I'd watched like different students, even in high school, you know, there were the kids who'd go away and be exchange students, or university, I had friends who would go and do things like teach English in Japan or go backpacking wherever. And I just hadn't had the opportunity to do anything like that yet. And I had a job opportunity to travel to London to take a role as global style director of a newspaper, a free daily called Metro, which was, you know, offered all over the world globally. And I jumped at the chance because it was a, you know, an opportunity to live elsewhere and to just kind of go out and see the world in a different way from just going on vacation. You know, it was a place to really bed into another country and get a whole different experience.
And talk about the book and living abroad and being a Black girl in the UK versus a Black girl in America. Is there similarities or is it totally different?
Well, I think there are certain shared experiences that transcend regions and countries and boundaries. And then I think there are, you know, some very real differences. There's an essay in my book called Skin Folk, in which I explore something called the diaspora wars, and that very real notion that, you know, we all come from different places. And while there's a shared experience, that, you know, there is, our lives look different based on, you know, where we've grown up and the lives that we've led. So, you know, my experience having grown up in Virginia looks very different from Funmi Feto, who contributed to the book, who grew up here in London. I'm the descendant of enslaved people in the States. Funmi's parents are from Lagos. I mean, so we have different cultural and historic reference points, but we have lots of similarities. You know, we both navigate the fashion and beauty worlds, which, you know, both are incredibly homogeneous, overwhelmingly white. And so that can be quite an isolating and exhausting experience. So we share that. But then, you know, as a part of our friendship, you know, we're just learning so many different things about one another. I mean, and that's the case with so many girlfriends in my network. One of my closest, dearest longtime friends, she's from Ghana. She was raised in New York, went to boarding school in Ghana, came back. I met her when I was at university. We befriended one another. And growing up in Virginia, I mean, you were either Black or white. I mean, there wasn't any real sort of notion of like origin beyond that. I mean, it was so polarized in terms of race, like that's just what it was. And so there wasn't any real sort of thinking about where are you from beyond that, like we're from Virginia and that's that. Whereas, you know, I went to university and then I moved to New York and my network just it broadened and expanded. And then I began to realize that, you know, there are people who don't feel Black until they set foot in the States, you know, and there are people who grew up in countries where Blackness is the default. These are things that I, you know, I touch upon this sort of growing awakening, for lack of a better term, about how sort of race and our concept of it changes from place to place and region to region, and what that looks like in my network, in my community of girlfriends.
And that's interesting. And we talk about expat and online, and I had collaborated with a couple of ladies that was from other countries. And one particular lady was from the Netherlands. And she had said to me about, she says, gosh, in the States, you guys are so much into race and color. And in the Netherlands, we are not like that. And so that was interesting, Kenya, that you just pointed out the differences in reference to how growing up in America, it is about color, which is pretty amazing.
Yeah, I mean, I think there can be the false perception that race isn't the issue here, that it is stateside. And so I think people get lulled into a false sense of reality, to be honest, because discrimination very much so exists in the Netherlands. You know, I have friends who are Black who live there who attest to it. Same way here in the UK, I can definitely attest to the fact that race is an issue and a factor here as well. And racism is alive and well. And so I think that is a real misconception that people have. I mean, I even had it moving here. I kept hearing, you know, that you go to the UK and you move to Europe and all of a sudden things feel more post-racial. I mean, I remember even growing up with this idea, which is another thing that I touch on in the book, that notion of Black Americans moving elsewhere to other countries where they feel more human. I mean, going back to the civil rights movement and even before that, you know, there's like such a huge and rich history of everyone from, you know, Josephine Baker to James Baldwin to writers like Carlene Hatcher Polite. Moving to France, you know, England, Russia even, and finding that their humanity was recognized in a way that it wasn't stateside, particularly during the era of Jim Crow and things like Reconstruction, for instance. So, you know, you'd be here in the States and you wouldn't be able to sort of walk through the entrance that everyone else was walking through or sit in a certain place on the bus or whatever. And then you go back, then you go abroad and you feel like your humanity is being acknowledged and recognized. And so I think that is a very real thing. Mind you, the racism here doesn't always feel as pronounced and overt as it is back home. And the history looks a little bit different, but that doesn't mean that it doesn't exist here and that it's no less insidious. And I think that if you were to look at statistics, if you were to look at the wealth gap between white families and Black families here, for instance, or the number of Black youth who are stopped and searched in comparison to their white counterparts, I mean, those two things alone will, you know, make it very clear and apparent that, you know, racism is very much alive and present in the UK and beyond.
Talk about COVID-19 and the UK and your life.
So I think COVID-19, you know, has had a real impact on everyone here. I mean, I think in terms of the conversation around race, I think it was quite interesting because with COVID-19, there was a real feeling that it was becoming like the great equalizer and that people were, you know, I was seeing pundits on news networks and things say, you know, now that we have COVID, you know, the conversation around identity politics is moot. You know, it's the great equalizer. It doesn't see race. It doesn't see class. But then we quickly learned that that wasn't the case and that COVID was, you know, disproportionately impacting Black people, people from other marginalized groups. We realized, you know, very quickly that in fact, COVID was not an equalizer. In fact, it was really just making longstanding entrenched inequalities, you know, even more apparent. And then I think there was a conversation around the essential work, key workers, like what does that really mean and who is really doing all this essential work? And, you know, it was clear that Black women in particular were, you know, constituting a decent amount of a fair number of essential workers. The vast majority are, you know, marginalized people. So I thought it was really fascinating from that standpoint, but then also just the sheer magnitude of it for all of us, regardless of race or background, age, gender, all of that, just the fact that we were living through, you know, a pandemic in a way that no one really saw it coming. And so all of a sudden we were in lockdown and just really wrapping our heads around the fact that this thing isn't going away. And here we are a year later. We're seeing this, you know, the silver lining here in the UK. They've started rolling out the vaccine, watching the news and seeing, you know, a 90-year-old man who's the first to receive the vaccine was really heartening in a real sort of show of like the light at the end of the tunnel after a really long year of COVID. But also it's going to be quite some time before we reach the end of that tunnel still. So I think, yeah, we'll all be living with COVID for quite some time. And I think a lot of the questions that have come out of this, I think we'll be discussing for quite some time as well.
What can we do right now to support you and your book, Kenya?
Oh, well, I mean, just reading it, I think would be amazing. I'd love to. I mean, I'm just so happy that it's out there. I mean, there was a risk, you know, at the start of COVID when everything shut down, like factories and printers, everything ground to a halt. So I wasn't even sure if my book would see the light of the day, as, you know, many of my peers who are authors were wondering the same thing. So I'm just so glad that it's out there in the world. Seeing people reading the book and engaging with it and hearing their feedback has been so heartwarming and, you know, has just been so incredibly gratifying because I just didn't even know if I'd be in this position. So I think just reading the book and taking the time to sit down with it would definitely be amazing.
And where can they find the book?
You can find the book ideally in most places that books are sold. So, you know, that's the more obvious players like Amazon and Barnes & Noble. I think I saw it on a Target website and things like that. But I'd also like to encourage people to really support their local bookshops, ideally their Black-owned bookshops, because these smaller businesses have really greatly been impacted this year in the age of COVID. I mean, people aren't necessarily going to stores and browsing as they would have been. And bookshops are such, you know, they're so needed in our local communities. You know, they're such a safe space in a lot of ways. So I think I'd like to encourage the people who are interested in buying the book to consider buying it from, you know, their local independent shops. And if it's Black owned, all the better.
Talk to a younger Kenya. What advice would you give to a younger you?
I think the advice I would give to a younger me is to just be kinder to myself and to just know that, you know, all you can do is the best that you can do. I do a lot of mentoring. I mentor quite a few students who are at university level. And I remember this myself when I was at university and even in high school. Sometimes, not everyone, but oftentimes you can become so achievement focused and like putting so much pressure on yourself to try to, you know, keep just pushing, you know, yourself. I think especially students now, because things in school seem so high stakes. You know, you're trying to get to the GPA to get into the right university, to get the right job. And then once you've got the right job, you're trying to accomplish X number of things by the age of 30. And then from there, you're trying to accomplish, or first by 25, then by 30. And there are all these milestones. And I just think we put so much pressure on ourselves. And it's only now in mentoring all these young kids who are in college and recent graduates that I'm recognizing that, oh my God, I was that person. Because now that I have the wisdom of time and age, I just think you have, you know, there's so much life ahead that we have to live and we'll be working for so long that it is perfectly okay to just take some time and really think through what you're doing and give it your best. And sometimes things don't work out and that's okay too. So I wish someone had really just sat me down and explained that to me, because I feel like in my 20s, we were all kind of like in a bit of a race out of school to just sort of like grab the most out of life and make the most out of it, which is great. But also along with that, it can become quite complicated. Because, you know, then we put pressures on ourselves that can be complicated and unhealthy and, yeah, not always the best thing for one's emotional well-being.
There are so many brands and businesses that are dominating. Talk about a brand or a business that's dominating that you admire and why.
a brand or a business. I don't know. There's quite a, I mean, I work in the fashion space there. You know, there's so many brands on so many different levels. I mean, I guess I'm really impressed by some of the younger, more emerging brands who have really kind of come to the fore in the past year, who are actually doing a lot of societal good. I mean, I really admire and respect Aurora James, who is an incredible woman, a Black woman based in New York, who has a footwear label called Brother Veli. And, you know, she started out designing shoes and she could have just left it at that, like just designing really beautiful shoes and bags. But I mean, she really used her platform to do a lot of good in that, you know, she really actively and has been doing the work for so long of really speaking about the need to increase equity and representation within fashion so that the balance can be redressed so that Black designers and Black business owners can have opportunities and grow and thrive. So she launched an initiative off the back of the tragic murder of George Floyd called the 15% Project, in which she's challenging and encouraging other brands, particularly the large mass market corporate ones, to dedicate 15% of their buy or their shelf space to Black-owned businesses to reflect the demographics of the country. And she has honestly like gained so much ground in the past however many months since she launched it. I think I want to say it's been about 5 or 6 months now. She's been such a change agent. She was featured on the cover of American Vogue. This painter, Jordan Castile, painted her portrait for the cover of the September issue. And she's been, you know, she's just been recognized by quite a lot of impressive brands. And this was basically a small, independently run footwear label producing really beautiful shoes. And she's had an impact globally that far outweighs the size of her business. And so I find her to be really quite influential, and I really admire what she's done. And also, I just love her brand. The shoes are really beautiful.
Talk about being in fashion and the role that you play in fashion.
Within fashion, I'm currently fashion director at a magazine called Grazia. And prior to that, I was deputy editor of Elle, a British Elle. And I spent a period of time as the global style director at, you know, the Metro newspapers, as I mentioned before. I started my career at a magazine called Jane. So I've been in women's media for quite a long time. I've seen a lot of change from a time when magazines were the default and everyone read print to now, where everyone's scrolling, addicted to their feeds, and magazine brands are no longer magazine brands, but media brands that grab readers at a number of touch points, whether it be on Instagram or TikTok or Snapchat or their website, you know, or Facebook. You know, it's these titles, these legacy magazine titles and newspapers for that matter, exist in a number of different places. Yeah, I mean, that's the landscape in which I work, and it's here. I started out in New York, and now I'm doing it here.
Did you find it was easy to break in?
It, you know, wasn't particularly easy. I think particularly fashion media, it's such an insular world and it's so relationship driven. I mean, I remember growing up and people, when I was in school, they said, you know, I would always hear, it's who you know, you have to know someone. It's, you have to really be careful of how you develop your relationships because it's all about who you know. And I think there's quite a lot of industries that are like that. Like I think a lot of creative industries, entertainment, music, film, television, it's really relationships driven. So for me, because I didn't grow up around anyone, I didn't have any family members or any family friends for that matter who worked in the fashion industry or business. I didn't really have any prior ins. So for me, it just really came down to writing a lot of letters. For me, it wasn't even fashion. It was just, I wanted to be at a title like that I really admired. So I was writing lots of letters to editors of The Village Voice, Vibe Magazine, Time, all of the titles that I enjoyed reading as a university student, all the women's magazines. I just canvassed everyone and I would just write lots and lots of emails to the editors who I identified on the masthead, hoping that someone would answer and let me intern for them, come up to New York and intern for them. And eventually I got through and a few did, and I was able to intern, you know, get my first internships in New York. And then from there, I just kept building and growing from there.
And what advice would you give someone now if they're interested in going into the fashion industry?
Well, I mean, I think in a way it's almost a bit easier because I think social media and the internet demystifies it a bit. Like people are so much more savvy now than they were then, because we have much more access. I mean, when I was coming up, runway shows weren't being streamed online. Like everyone, you know, now you get everything. You get the runway show streamed online. You get the behind the scenes footage. You get the interviews with the designer. Almost every sort of touch point in the experience of, you know, what fashion is, you know, everything from the supply chain, how the clothes are made, to the magazine imagery, who stars on the covers, to the runway shows, to the commercials. We see it online, but we also see the making of it online. And then we see discussion about the making of it. Like if you are a student, you can find out all of it. Like it's all there. And then not only that, you can find the people who are the major players, because they're all on Instagram. They're all on Facebook. They're all on Twitter. So I think the access is incredibly different because the tools are so different. You know, whereas before I'd read the magazines and I'd be Googling, trying to hunt down someone's email address, which was much harder to find because that stuff was under lock and key. Like there weren't the same databases that are so easily accessible now where you can just look up someone's details and you find it or get hold of it much easier than when I was coming up. Or you could just slide into someone's DMs on Instagram. I don't always recommend people do that though. So yeah, I think it's just much easier. So what I would recommend is that the students who are interested in getting jobs in this field after school, just keep being good students in that, study the industry. Like if you're interested in being a fashion journalist, find out who the best ones are. You know, like, do you know who Vanessa Friedman is with the New York Times? Do you know who Tim Blanks is with the Business of Fashion? Do you know who Robin Givhan is at the Washington Post? And are you reading them regularly? Because these are the people who are at the top of the field who are shaping the conversation around fashion. Do you know who those designers are, the major houses who are, you know, setting the agenda and really the driving mechanisms behind the industry in terms of the clothes we wear and the shapes of the dresses and the hemlines of the trousers and the change and the, you know, the fluctuations and the fabrics and the color choice of the skirts, like the ingoing and outgoing trends. Like these are the people. Do you know who the people are who are really driving this stuff? Do you really know it? So it's really about studying the field that you want to be a part of, so that when you do land those first interviews, you can really impress the hiring parties with your knowledge. And because and then that shows hunger. I mean, as someone who hires people in and currently filling some vacancies on my team, I'm always impressed by people who are hungry and who have done their homework. So I really just advise that people do your homework and that you stay ready so that you don't have to get ready. You know, it's like we do all this time, like looking for job interviews and stuff. And then when you get it, are you ready to answer all those curveball questions and stuff? So if you're always doing your homework, you don't have to worry about feeling caught off guard when someone asks you something during a job interview that you might not have necessarily felt prepared for.
Speaking of reading, what are you reading now and why?
What I'm reading now. So I've just wrapped up reading a few things. I'm currently not reading anything at this very minute because I've been spending every ounce of free time promoting the book. But I just, the last two books that I read, which I loved and really impacted me greatly, was Isabel Wilkerson's Cast, which is incredible. I mean, so incredible and is so brilliantly reported and does such a great job of explaining how we've gotten to this place where we are now, in this, you know, really incredibly polarized year in which race has been such a big talking point, particularly in the States, particularly in elections. She just basically draws parallels and connects dots between the history of racism in the States with the caste system in India and the Holocaust in Germany. And so it's quite a heavy read, but it's really good. I also highly recommend her first book, The Warmth of Under Other Suns, which charts the great migration in the States and really does an incredible job of really showing you the stories and the faces of the great migration, and also just looking at its legacy and, you know, and how we still sort of live with the effects of it to this day. And then a book written by a woman here called Whites by Ikeda Uwagba. It's just a tiny, tiny little book. It's an essay. It's basically a long essay. You could read it in an evening, and it's basically her experiences navigating white guilt off the back of George Floyd's murder and how exhausting that was for her. And she's written it kind of specifically for the white audience, which I find to be really quite fascinating. As a Black woman reading it, I think, you know, anyone can read it and it'll strike a chord with them. It's quite amazing. And so Atega is quite a force of nature herself. She's based here in London. And yeah, so those are the two that I've read recently, which I was really impressed by.
Kenya, talk about your top two influencers and what lessons did they teach you?
Well, I guess it's, people who maybe are peers who I admire, one would be Aurora James, who I mentioned before, and the work she's done with Brother Veli. And then I guess maybe like pie in the sky, like people who I'm so far removed from, but I'm just have so much gratitude for. It would, you know, Barack and Michelle Obama, which I think a lot of people would cite and quote. I mean, they're just so, I think my girlfriends and I, every time like we see them or get a glimpse of them, we just, you know, it's just hard to believe that we had them in the White House for 8 years. It's almost like we knew it was great and incredible, but then when everything happened afterwards, it's like, God, like we didn't even really know how good it was or how bad things could get, or we had forgotten maybe. I mean, it was such an incredible period. And so, yeah, I have his book that I'm waiting to get into next after I finish this book tour. But yeah, I mean, I think there are just such bright shining lights. So I think, I feel like that's quite a basic answer, but I think it's, you know, they're both on my mind because I've got his book sitting on my nightstand right there.
What problem exists in the world today that you would like to solve?
Yeah, wow, that's a big question. I think because my book speaks to the complications of, well, it speaks about the joy of being Black, but it also speaks to the complications of it as well. And I think also given, you know, a lot of the major sort of headlines and talking points this year, I mean, I think racism would obviously be a big one. And, you know, inequality, I would say inequality in general, as it impacts so many of us, whether it be people from marginalized backgrounds or, you know, gender inequality. I mean, it's a really, really big one, but I guess in a sort of dream pie in the sky world, I mean, I if I could tackle and, you know, do away with inequality, I think that would be pretty incredible.
If there's one thing that you can change in your life, what would it be?
If I could change one thing in my life, well, right now, I think because the distance from home is feeling quite pronounced, it would be wanting to just be with my parents. You know, they're in Virginia. I miss them so much. So I would just, you know, I just want to be with my parents right now and my sister who's in New York. Like I've never been away from home for so long. So that's the thing that I would change in a heartbeat.
Talk about legacy. When it's all said and done, Kenya, how do you want to be remembered?
I'd love to be remembered as someone who has, you know, helped make a lot of positive change. So in terms of the fashion space, you know, I've been working hard to try to help change the face of it, create opportunities for young people of color who might not have necessarily had opportunities within fashion before. And then in terms as an author, you know, I would love to be remembered for having written books that inspire women and allow them to feel seen and recognized and also inspired to just inhabit the fullness of who they are and to revel in it and to, yeah, and to revel in it.
What do you need right now that you don't have that would move the needle forward in your career or your business?
That's a good question. I mean, time. I think time for sure. There are all these things. I mean, even in the workday, there's just so much to do always. I just wish I had more time to do it. Like I go to sleep at night and I've got like, you know, I'm falling asleep and all these things are popping up into my head that emails I need to send, the post office. I don't, you know, I'm working from home. I don't have the post room anymore. There's so many, I love to send people handwritten notes or packages, particularly with a book. I have a backlog packages that need to get out to people with books and thank you notes and things like that. So that's just a really tiny example, but I mean, it's just time basically. And theory, I mean, we all thought that we were going to be in this year of COVID, you know, swimming in free time, but that has not been my experience at all. I feel like every minute of the day has been accounted for.
And talking about your book, did you self-publish or did you go through an agent?
So I have a literary agent and it's published by HarperCollins, the Amistad imprint. And here it's the HQ imprint. And so, yeah, I, you know, was fortunate enough to have a literary agent who went out and brokered the book deal, you know, with HarperCollins, and she's amazing, Kate. And, you know, she's almost like having a second editor because, you know, she's been with me from the very, very beginning when I first had the idea for this book. And she's someone who I really workshopped it with. And, you know, my editor was an integral, you know, both actually, because I had an editor in the UK and an editor here in the US. And Tara Parsons, who's my editor here, is, you know, incredible. And so she was great in terms of being a sounding board and allowing me to sort of workshop these essays. But my agent was also just so instrumental to that process as well.
And talk about the process for vetting an agent.
I think it's like, I mean, I'm no expert because I don't have a huge history of publishing books. But for me, the chemistry was the big thing, because you're really kind of entrusting your work to this person, because they're really being an advocate for you to try to make sure you know, that your work winds up in the best hands. And so I think chemistry also, because it's really important that you feel understood by the person who is representing you, and also that you just like each other. You know, my agent, I mean, she's so smart. She really gets it. I feel like we consume a lot of the same things. I feel like she really understands me and understands what I'm trying to do with this book, but also just in general. And so that was really important to me.
Talk about the person in your lineage who has given you the most provocative advice.
I have to have a think. I mean, my mother, you know, is incredible. And a lot of the advice that she's given me over time growing up has really stood out. She advises me on a number of things, like big, big, major sort of life issues. And then just little things like, you know, what I should be wearing for X occasion, or how I should do my hair. And so, I mean, I can't remember anything that's too terribly provocative right now from anyone that I could think of. But I know my mother, she's just a constant sounding board, giving me advice whether I want it or not, because that's what mothers do. You know, I'm really grateful to her for always doing that. And then I think my editor, Tara, gave me some really useful advice with the book, in that she told me at the outset, you know, just to really focus on telling my truth, you know, speaking to my experience. Because I think sometimes when you're writing a book that is, you know, that leans really quite heavily on cultural commentary. I mean, my book has bits of memoir, but there's a lot of commentary about the cultural and political in it. I really didn't want to sort of, there's always the risk that you sort of, you start speaking for entire groups of people or speaking for movements and things like that. And that's something I definitely did not want to do. And I didn't quite know how to articulate it. I just knew that was a fear that I had when I was starting the writing process. I just wanted to be extra careful not to do that. Even now, when I hear people say things like, oh, she's a voice of a generation, not that anyone would even dare to say that about me. I'm just saying, as a journalist, when I read people placing that on other writers, I tend to roll my eyes and just think, you know, this isn't so good, you know, to really put it upon one person to speak for an entire sort of group of people. And so for me, with the book, I really, you know, it's a commentary on the experience of Black womanhood through my own personal experiences. So I can really only speak to my truth and my experiences.
What is the hope for your generation?
I mean, I think the hope is just that we can, you know, I was talking about in the book how we don't always get the luxury of just being normal, you know, or just being regular sometimes. We don't, I grew up with this feeling that you have to be twice as good to get just as much, or some people say twice as good to get half as much, or that sort of thing. And on the one hand, we rise to the occasion and then some. I mean, Black excellence is who we are, but I would love to just see us in a place where we can literally just be free of context. And I think women of all races can relate to this as well, because I think this is something that's also really tied to the experience of being a woman as well. But anyone who, you know, has to navigate narrow expectations of them, or, you know, societal expectations that can be quite restrictive. And for Black women, that goes for everything from our hair, the way it is, the way we wear it, to the way we speak, the way we live our lives, when we choose to have children, if we do, if we don't, like all of it. You know, I would just love to see us reach a place where we can just be, and that existence be free from any sort of subtext.
What drives you every day to continue doing what you do?
I think I genuinely, legitimately enjoy my work. And so I think that enjoyment definitely drives it. I think the minute I stop enjoying what I'm doing, I definitely would have to take a step back and really reassess and reconsider what, you know, what I'm doing and where I'm headed.
What would you have done differently if you can do it over again?
I don't know. I mean, I think I try not to spend too much time thinking about things I would do differently, because I don't know if there's any real point in it. I mean, I do like to reflect on mistakes I've made and try to learn how not to repeat those mistakes. But going back and doing things differently, I don't know. I can't think of, you know, even the things that I've gotten wrong, you know, I just roll with it, because I feel like that's a part of the experience of life, you know, and the making of me. So I don't know if I would necessarily do anything differently. I know that might sound cliche, but I actually genuinely believe it as well, because I do feel quite content with where I am right now. You know, I love my family unit, but I guess maybe if I could do anything differently, I probably would have done a better job of sleep training my toddler, because I'm feeling a bit sleep deprived right now.
So tell us, did you find love in the UK?
We were dating in New York, actually. We started dating in New York, and I had this opportunity to move here, and he moved here on a whim as well. And he had an opportunity, you know, a gallery here in London had just picked him up. So yeah, we just moved. We moved here. We'd only been dating a year, and we thought we'd stay here for a year, 2 years max. And we got married. You know, we've been here together. So we moved here together and, like, you know, built a little life here together, not expecting to, because every year we grapple with the question of when to move back.
Is your family surprised that you stayed in the UK?
Yeah, I mean, I think they're definitely, their patience is running thin with it now. Every time we talk, they're like, okay, when are you coming back now? You've been there a really long time. So yeah, I think they probably are surprised that we've ended up being here this long. I mean, honestly, I'm surprised that we're still here. We have this conversation all the time. We're like, God, we can't believe we're here still, and that we've had two kids here, and that these two little people have British accents. Like, our sons have these little accents, and we, yeah. So, I mean, I know I'm surprised. So I'm sure our family is too.
If you conducted this interview, what is the one question you would have asked yourself? I want you to ask the question and answer it.
I don't know. I think maybe I'm trying to think. It's hard wearing both hats at once. Let me think about, you know, as someone who interviews people all the time, I guess maybe I'd ask myself about the experience of writing the book and doing that, you know, as a working mother with two small kids. And I would answer it by saying, yeah, you know, it's really quite difficult, you know, finding that time to write it and complete a book. I think it's hard to do now anyway, when you're just completely bombarded with distractions. I've met so many writers who talk about how they have to turn off all their applications on their devices so that they don't get any notifications, or they write on a laptop that has no email on it or no internet, no broadband or anything like that. Because that alone can be, you know, filled with distractions. And so I think with me, with two small children, it felt doubly hard. So for me, it was just really about, like, just trying to find moments to write as and when I could. And so, yeah, I guess that, because I'm always really curious to know how and where they write, basically, where their writing practices are. Even when I speak to people just conversationally who have written books, that's one of the first things I ask. So I guess I would, if I were interviewing myself, I'd ask myself that too.
We've come to the part of our interview is called Fun Facts Lightning Round. I'm going to ask you a series of questions. I'd like you to give me very quick answers. If there's something you desire not to answer, feel free to say pass. Are you ready, Kenya, for the Fun Facts Lightning Round?
Yep.
The last movie you saw?
The Wiz.
Your first job?
It was a retail job working at a clothing store called Express.
You relax doing what?
In a long, long hot bath with a book and a candle.
Your favorite singer or rapper?
My favorite singer or rapper? Ooh, that's a really, really hard one. There's too many to narrow down to one. I mean, I love everyone from, like, Aretha Franklin to Jasmine Sullivan to this new artist, Ari Lennox. I mean, I listen to them all. And then, I mean, Notorious B.I.G., Nas, Ghostface Killah. There's so many. Andre 3000. I could go on and on.
Your favorite dance song?
My favorite dance song? There's one called Brujas by Princess Nokia, which I've been dancing to quite a lot lately. It's not entirely new. She released it a couple years back, but I still love pulling it out and dancing to it.
What food do you eat every week, no matter what?
What food do I eat every week, no matter what? I try to eat something green as regularly as I possibly can. So yeah, I mean, I try to eat according to the rainbow to make sure I'm getting a nice sort of decent variety of nutrients.
Your favorite month?
I love August because that's the month of summer holidays, you know, and that's usually the month of extended trips home to the States for me. Equally, I love Christmas so much. So I love December as well.
Workout or hit the couch?
Workout. I'm having a hard time finding the time to do it lately. It's actually been really hard to find the time, but yeah, definitely workout for me.
Kenya Hunt, thank you so much for joining us on Black Entrepreneur Experience Podcast. Before we let you go, why don't you share with our audience the best way for them to connect with you, and feel free to give all your social media handles.
Yeah, I'm on all the apps. So yeah, Instagram, I'm Kenya Hunt. I think engage the most there. And then Twitter, I'm Kenya in Hunt. And then Facebook, I just don't check Facebook that much anymore. So I think you can usually find me between Twitter and Instagram.
Kenya, thank you. That's a wrap.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations, Arielle from Stone Mountain, Georgia, our April winner. Our guests have sent us so much swag, books, and giveaways this year. I can't wait to announce our monthly winner. So if you want exclusive content delivered right to your inbox and to enter into our monthly drawing, go to drfrancesrichards.com and subscribe to our mailing list. That's drfrancesrichards.com. drfrancesrichards.com. That's drfrancesrichards.com. And subscribe to our mailing list. We promise we will not spam you or sell your information.
Thank you for listening and subscribing to Black Entrepreneur Experience. We would love for you to leave a review and rating on iTunes and share with your friends. For show notes and more episodes, go to www.beepodcast.com. Join us next Wednesday, and remember, green is the new black. So keep your bank accounts and your business in the black.